Okay, well, it's 5 o'clock here in Kuching, Malaysia, so we're going over the border. It's going to take us 12-hour drive, so it's a long way. So we want to be there before dark. We want to get home before dark, so it's going to be good. It'll be good to see everybody again. Years ago we left Australia to come to Borneo. We decided to move over to Kalimantan and we set up a couple of ministries there, planting churches as well as bringing children in. And how we did that was, why we did that was because we realized preaching the gospel to a tribe, telling them about Jesus while they're hungry or while they're sick and knowing full well there is no means of getting better, just didn't make any sense. It didn't make sense to them, and it really didn't make sense to us. How do you tell a person that Jesus loves them when they're dying of starvation? God challenged us to start bringing these kids in that are neglected. And so it started off with one kid, and then we had seven girls we started off with, because the girls in particular, when they reach the age of 11, 12, 13, and they have their first period, they're married off to these old men who've already got a couple of wives that just want another slave around the place. But these young kids, they fall pregnant straight away. By the time they're 20, they've already had 5 or 6 kids. They don't know how to love their kids. They neglect them. And so we decided that we need to do something. I can't just do nothing about it. We said, God, we don't have any money to do this, but we trust in you that you will provide for us, so for food and clothing and school and everything. And you know, at the end of the month, the money was there. It wasn't just enough. It wasn't too much and not too little. Extra money had come in just to be able to care for these girls. So we were so excited. Our faith, of course, went through the roof. And then we said, okay, God, if you can do it with 7, you can do it with 30. What happened at the end of the month again, somebody had sent money over, extra, just enough to pay for the cost of living for these 30 girls. So it was fantastic to see God work that way. God was testing our faith as well and stretching our faith more and more to believe that God can do much more than we were thinking, in a way. And so we thought, well, God, if you can do it with 30, you can do it with 70. And it went on from there. And God challenged us, look, I want you to think bigger. I want you to dream bigger. I want you to understand that I can do anything. Can do anything. If he created the heavens and the earth and everything that it's in it, well, then he can do anything. And so he challenged us then. He said, I want you to start a place for 1,000 neglected children, 1,000, and build schools for 2,000, 1,000 that live with us and 1,000 that live in the region that can walk to school every day. So for me, it was like 1,000 kids. God, you know, I got about 30 in my house at that time, or I can't remember exactly how many I had, but I said, they drive me up the wall now, and you want me to have 1,000 kids? We looked everywhere. We went everywhere to look for land. We took a motorbike, we took the car, canoe, speedboat, on foot. Then after 10 months, I was getting very impatient and a little bit annoyed with the Lord, because I said to him, you know, if you want us to start with these, help these neglected children, then you're going to have to give us the land. I mean, you're going to have to show us where we can start. And so that night I went to bed and I grabbed the Bible and I read to my wife in bed the Psalms 37. I started to read and I got to verse 34. And it said, don't be impatient for the Lord to act, but travel steadily in his path. He will honor you by giving you the land. That's what it said. My wife, she looked at me and she goes, see, be patient, she said. And I said, yes, darling, I'm sorry. And I said, God, I'm sorry. You know, I was being impatient. Then that Friday that arrived, this guy rings up from on the phone and he goes, are you the man looking for land? I said, yes. He goes, I've got land. Meet me at Nunga Pinoy at the coffee cafe, that and that coffee cafe, and then I'll take you to my land. I went there, I stopped there in front of the coffee cafe. This guy gets out of the coffee cafe, gets into my car and says, my land is that way. And I said, but I thought you said it was near the telecom tower. Aren't they that way? And he goes, no, that way is my land. So we travel for about 10 kilometers, an hour, so bad was the road. And eventually I said, aren't you the guy that rang me up on Friday to say that you've got land near the telecom tower? He says, no, I never rang you. I said, well, why did you get in my car when I stopped there near the coffee cafe? He said, I recognized your car. You're the guy who's looking for land. I've got land and it's this way. Another 15 minutes and we'll be there at the land. I said, no, I'm not falling for that one. I've learned over the years when the local people say 15 more minutes, it's 3 more hours and then still 15 more minutes. After 15 minutes, sure enough, we were there. I take you up to the highest point. He said, then you can see. So we walked up the hill and another hill and another hill, and then we finally got to this place here, and there was a tree, or trees everywhere, but I had to climb a tree in order to see the land. And as I was in the tree and I looked out, I just knew that this was the land. I mean, I could have cried at that when I saw the land, you know, the beauty of left to right and as far as I could see, and the hills and the valleys, and I just knew this was the land. Here on one of the high points of the property, but you've got actually a great view of most of the buildings you can see on this site here, which is fantastic. Then it really gives you an idea how quickly, in a way, everything has been set up in this 6.5 years that we've been here. I mean, it's big, but it's really little. For God, it's just, well, He can do anything. So, you know, we're just starting this off. I mean, there's so much more to be built. Another 100 buildings or more. The funds are coming in from all over the place. Just ordinary people that are supporting kids and supporting the work and putting in a little bit here and a little bit there. And there are some big donors as well. But I mean, everybody is pitching in and making it happen. Okay, here we're in one of the gardens. Every children's home has their own garden. So the boys actually learn to grow different crops. Most villages where they come from, they only grow rice, and often the rice harvest fails and then they've got nothing to eat anymore. So a lot of hunger, a lot of kids die of starvation. So we try and encourage them to do multi-cropping, but they don't want to do that because they've never learned to do that. We need about 10 tons of vegetables a month now. We grow about 5 tons ourselves, and we buy 5 tons. I think it's approximately like that. And so with 400 people, 400 and with all the workers, but so that's only going to increase. So we're trying to produce our own vegetables so that we're going to be self-sufficient as possible. We use about 6 tons of rice a month, which is an enormous amount of rice. But we found out that it's actually cheaper to buy the rice than to grow it yourself, because the government still subsidizes rice. So we're not going to try and grow rice yet, but vegetables definitely Fruit, definitely. We've got 1,200 fruit trees already up and already picking fruit from that. So it's every year getting more and more, which is fantastic. I want fruit every day, or at least a couple of times a week that we have fruit to eat, which is again good for their diet. This is one of our young fellows that lives here, and his name is Sion, and he came from one of the villages where one of our leaders went to. Her family lived there, but when she went over there to visit them, she came across this young fellow here, and his father died already last year, and his mother was mentally disturbed. She already had killed his two-year-older brother. He'd already beaten him to death, and now she was beating him up. And so when Anna saw him being beaten up, she went to try to stop it, but wouldn't. So she went to the tribal chief and asked the tribal chief, look, you know, I heard that the mother already beaten up the two-year-older brother to death, and looks like she's going to do the same with him. Wouldn't it be better for us to take him to our village so that he can live there in a safe place? So the tribal chief agreed with that. So he came to us, and ever since he came here, I mean, the first couple of days he was here, he just was glued to me. Everywhere I went, he followed me. And he kept on saying, you know, I just love it here so much. Can I really stay here? Is this my home, and am I allowed to stay here? And I said, yep, this is your home now. This is where you're allowed to live for as long as you want. Okay, here we make our own cement blocks, and we do this because working with wood is quite expensive now. Even though we're in the tropical jungles, it's difficult to get wood, and it's very expensive now. It's almost as expensive as working with these blocks. So we thought this is much better. The houses are stronger, the houses are cooler when you make blocks, and it's easier to work with. Here we have our medical clinic where we can treat our people on the property here, but also in the immediate region around here, so people can come here and get medical treatment. It's got a couple of, we have an ER in there, emergency room, and there's a couple of dentist places here so they can get dental work done. An x-ray machine we want here. So it'll have everything that a small little country hospital has. Here we've got our generators, because we've got to supply our own electricity. The government doesn't have electricity for us here. These supplied 80 kVA. When we put in a newsletter that we were after our school and our children's homes don't have any electricity, a little church in England, they decided to sell their church building and to give the proceeds to us so that we can buy four of these machines so that we can have power. Our own power supply. They now meet in a little school building, and they're hiring one of those classrooms where they can meet together. But I thought, what a sacrifice that these people made to help us, you know? So these are enormous machines that give us now power 24 hours a day. So what an incredible blessing. You know, it's not my project. It's God's project. And God is just using me to do this and using somebody else to do something else. But it's the body of Christ working together. And the result is that you've got a place here, which is in the process of being built, where lots of kids and young people are being rescued. Rescued from where they've come from, and giving them a new start in life so that they can meet with God and so they can make something fantastic of their lives. So, karena Yesus, semua karena Yesus, tak mampu diriku tetap berdiri tegak. Terima kasih Yesus. People are coming from all over the world to come and spend some of their time, a couple of weeks or a month, here to give us their holiday time. We need to have architects and engineers and builders and carpenters and electricians and all these sort of people. Other people come, like mums and dads and mothers who can do cooking and cleaning and sewing and you name it, or even just reading books to the kids or whatever. You know, everybody can help out, and that's the beauty of this place, I think, that it's open to anybody who wants a taste of missions and anybody who wants to come and help to keep this place running and to get it off the ground. So it's such a blessing to see that. This is Rina here, and she was really from a very poor family. I really didn't, no money at all, hardly any money to pay for food alone. She was very skinny when she arrived here, and her skin was all sick and that, and as wild as anything. But now to see her now reading and writing and enjoying school is fantastic to see her now having this opportunity to do that. Here we have Sissy. Sissy's from the Mate tribe, and she's she was a little alcoholic when she came here, and her father brought her here because every day apparently her grandmother gave her rice wine because she believed the witch doctor said that to give the rice wine to her so that to keep the evil spirits out of her body. But of course she was starting to get used to all this rice wine every day and started to enjoy it as well. And her father realized that this was not going to go anywhere. So he brought her here and he said, please take my daughter because she's going to die otherwise in my village. And so we took her in, but she swore and cursed and screamed and you carried on the first day like terrible. And we thought, well, what are we going to do with her? You know, how are we going to handle this one? But, you know, we just got people together. We prayed for her and we just asked God for a solution to give us some wisdom and how to deal with this sort of thing. And she went to sleep and got up in the next morning and she was fine. I mean, she spoke normal, she played normal, she didn't scream, shout, curse anymore. And it was just fantastic to see her completely change. And now here, she's reading and writing now. We've had kids here that have already killed other kids, have eaten kids, who were prostitutes, who were drug addicts, and all that sort of stuff. And now they're no longer that way and now enjoying going to school and enjoying a life that is meant for them to enjoy. When you drive in this place here, it's got a sign there and it says, be aware, you are entering a miracle zone. And truly, it is a miracle zone. Even the people in the region here know that this is a miracle place, a place where miracles happen. Some of the people are even afraid of us because they know that the hand of God is upon this place. You know, we had a grasshopper plague a couple of years ago, and the whole entire region was affected by this grasshopper plague. It ate all the rice crops and the vegetable gardens and the fruit trees, ate it all up. The grasshoppers landed on the roads here on this property, but it never touched our gardens. It never touched our fruit trees. And so everybody was wondering, how on earth do these grasshoppers know that this is your property? You know, so people know that God's hand is on this place. Thousands of people were affected by this plague of grasshoppers, except the 200 and odd hectares of land that we had. So everybody, one of our boys came back from Nunga Pinoy and said, Dad, do you know what they're saying in the region? And I said, no. He said, don't mess with those people on this property because their God is with them. And I said, they said that? And he said, yes. I said, well, good. Well, let them spread it around a little bit more. All right, we're going to Ankabang now, which is a village about 4 hours away from here. We're taking our medical box with us so we can treat people who are sick, as well as we're taking our Bible with us so we can share the gospel message of love and salvation to them. So it's going to be good. Let's go. Usually we drive there for a while and then either we take a boat for a while and then go on foot. Sometimes we walk for 6, 7, 9 hours on foot before we can reach a village. It's the only way to get there. Got to go through rivers, you got to go through mud pools and all sorts of stuff. It's always an adventure, a challenge to get there, but it's always fantastic to meet up with the people there. Right, well, this is as far as we go, by car anyway. We've got to go later on across the river and then another an hour and a half walk or something. We go there and now and we're going to see whether we can help some people medically, also tell them about the Lord. Our vision is to get the gospel message out into those tribal areas where they have never ever heard the gospel before. Difficult areas where no one really wants to go, but God wants us to go there because God loves people. God's desire is to see people saved, to be people set free. This is Benny's house here. So his mum and dad live in here in this place. So ini anak bapak di mana yang ini ya. Okay, we're just going to go and have a bath now. This is a creek, but it runs in the major river over there. So we're going to have a bath in the major river there. We'll have plenty of water. No privacy, but who cares? You know, some villages you come to and have built these idols there that they worship, and every day they make sacrifices to all these things. They're so influenced by witch doctors that make them do all sorts of horrific things. You know, and they're afraid, they're scared, they are abused in every way. We find kids that are barely alive sometimes. When I take them to the doctor to get a checkup and they go, "Mister, if you had left them there for another week, they wouldn't have made it." Take these two little ones back to our village because that's Benny's two brothers, but the father, as you've seen just before, he's blind and can't work anymore, so he doesn't have an income, so it's going to be difficult to feed the family, and so it's best for us to take them with us. They want us to take them with us so that we can feed them and school them, and so that's not going to be a burden to them anymore.